You're in this course, presumably, to go into an allied health field, work as a nurse or a surgical technician or dental hygienist, a number of different possible career paths you could be pursuing. And to do your job effectively, you're going to have to communicate with other health professionals. And language is very important to that. In science in general, precision is terribly important so that everybody knows exactly what they're talking about. And so we're going to touch on language a little bit here. And as we study the human body, we're going to learn a lot of terms that you'll need to know exactly what they mean, because you're going to be talking with other people that are going through different educational careers and learning this information differently, but you have to be talking about the exact same thing. And often people in this course are going to also be in positions where they interact not just with other health professionals, but are usually the point person to interact with patients, nurses especially. And so you need to understand how to translate the very jargon-rich medical terminology into everyday language that a patient with no background in medicine can understand and feel comfortable with. So we want to be very upfront in thinking about how important language is in a course like this and in the career that you're pursuing. An educational study was done a while back showing that you learn more new words, more new vocabulary in an introductory science class than you do in an introductory foreign language class. That the number of words that you're going to have to learn in a course is just much, much greater in a class like this one here. Now, I think part of that's probably because foreign language classes are not just teaching you a bunch of new words. You're learning about the culture that that language comes from, the syntax of that language, etc., etc. So you're going to learn very basic sentences like ¿dónde está la biblioteca in Spanish? When in a course like this, you're going to be learning things like the appendix is located in the right inguinal section of the abdominopelvic cavity. The syntax and the culture is inherently already there because it's just jargon added into English, not a completely new language and a new way of thinking culturally or syntactically. You learn a lot of new words in a course like this. I want to show you something to think about how to learn those words a little bit easier. All of the language that we're learning is basically built from parts taken from Latin and Greek, the two major languages that were used in education hundreds of years ago. You probably already recognize parts of certain words, and if you can just think about putting those parts together, you can build words and understand what they mean in a basic sense without having to look them up. You will probably have to look up some words to understand what they really mean, but this trick will get you part of the way there, and I want you to use it quite a bit in working through this course. That trick for learning these new words is based on etymology, which is essentially looking at the parts of words and how they tell you what the word means. So to illustrate that, let me begin by breaking down the word etymology itself. The root of the word etym comes from a Greek that means true, and ology means the study of. Now really, ology can be broken down further. L-O-G is the Greek word that means word, but in this sense, we're talking about studying things. Now put true and the study of together and you get a very basic meaning for etymology, which is the study of truth or the study of the true meaning of words. However, etymology isn't perfect at defining words, it just helps you understand what they basically mean. Now you probably are already familiar with anytime you see ology in a word, it's talking about sort of a discipline of academics, so to speak. There's somebody studying something, and it's just a matter of what that something that they're studying is. So when you see the word biology, you know it's the study of something, and it's just a matter of what does bio mean. You probably know that bio means life, and biology is a study of life or of living things. You see another word that has ology in it, like cytology, it's just a matter of defining what does cyto refer to. You may know that cyto means cell, and so cytology is the study of cells. Think of looking at cells through a microscope. That's essentially what a cytologist does. So if you see cyte in another word, knowing that cytology is the study of cells, then cyte means cell. Now, notice that cyte has an O after it, cytology, and it does not have that at the end of these other words. And that's just a matter of how we combine parts of words together, some rules to make the words flow a little bit better. So cyte, cyto, they are sort of the same thing. So hepatocytes or melanocytes are types of cells, and it's just a matter of knowing what hepato or melano mean. Hepato you might recognize, you've probably heard of hepatitis. That's a disease of the liver. And so hepatocyte is a liver cell. And then melanocyte, you might not recognize what melano means, but you've probably heard the word melanin, that's a pigment in the skin. Now, melano technically comes from words that mean black, and so melanocyte could be broken down to mean black cell. But really, melanin is a black pigment, and so melanocytes are the cells that make the black pigment melanin, which we find in the skin. Knowing that a melanocyte is the type of cell that makes melanin, melano referring to that pigment, when you see that part of a word in another word, it's probably referring to the same type of cell. Now, the ending OMA we associate with cancer, but really it means a growth. So a melanoma is an abnormal growth of melanocytes, which might just be a mole. Sometimes they can get out of control and become much more dangerous, but a simple melanocyte overgrowth or mole is a melanoma. These other two words that end in oma are other types of growths, actually, that are also associated with skin. An adenoma is a growth of glandular tissue, and a carcinoma is, etymologically speaking, a growth of cancer. But in common usage, carcinomas usually refer to epithelial cell growths. Not all the time, but generally that's where we see them. While we usually associate omas with cancer, that's not the best way of understanding what the words mean. There's another word, hematoma, that ends in the same thing, and that is not cancer. It's a bruise. Now, hemato or hemo refers to blood. So a hematoma is a growth of blood, which we understand that really a bruise is bleeding under the skin that can be seen. So it's not a growth of blood, it's just an expansion of blood into another tissue. But when the word was coined originally, they didn't quite understand what was going on in bruising, so it was called a growth of blood. Another oma, for instance, that doesn't mean cancer is Oklahoma. Insert laughter here. So just in looking over these words here in this short list, we get to this word, hemocytoblast. And you should know at least two-thirds of this word. Hemo, like in hematoma, means blood, and cyto, as in melanocyte, means cell. So all you really need to know to understand this word is what does blast mean. Now, blast actually comes from the Greek word that means flower bud, and that suggests something that has the potential to grow into another thing. Now, blast is used to describe a stem cell. So anything that you see the word blast in is a stem cell. So hemocytoblast is a blood cell stem cell, or more accurately, it's the cell in red bone marrow that gives rise to blood cells throughout your lifetime.
Consider this question. When you feel that you've reached an answer, hit the next button to go into the next slide, which will reveal the correct answer.
So from the terms that you learned in this section, you should be able to recognize that hematology is the study of blood. A hematologist is a person who looks at blood using the microscope or using other tools and can assess if somebody's anemic or somebody has a problem with particular blood cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, etc., etc.